Hi, I'm Laura Flanders, and this is City Works, a production of the City University of New York School of Labor and Urban Studies and CUNY TV. Each month, City Works examines the lives of working people on the job, at home, or in their communities here in New York City and the greater urban landscape. Today, we are talking about worker organizing and why many in the labor movement are feeling quite hopeful about the current landscape. There are the recent high-profile wins at Amazon and Starbucks, and public support for labor is up. A recent Gallup poll found that 68% of Americans and 77% of people aged 18 to 34 have a positive opinion of labor unions. We'll be speaking with a longtime organizer, Marianne LeNabat, about what she's seeing and about what's next for workers in these newly formed unions as they tackle uphill legal battles and contract negotiations. But first, I'd like to share excerpts from an interview I did on May 5th with the authors of an important new book, The Future We Need, Organizing for a Better Democracy in the 21st Century. The interview was part of a live CUNY SLU virtual public program, which I had the pleasure to conduct. Sarita Gupta is Vice President of U.S. Programs at the Ford Foundation. Erica Smiley is Executive Director of Jobs with Justice. Their book addresses building worker power and invoking collective bargaining to meet the needs of people in modern society to govern more aspects of their lives. The book weaves stories of real working people towards an understanding of how to negotiate in today and tomorrow. Let's pick up now with our discussion with the book's co-authors.
So the 30s, we saw this upsurge of worker mobilizations and actions we saw as a result, the creation of the National Labor Relations Act and the National Labor Relations Board, the Fair Labor Standard Act. But remember that this, we also excluded pretty large swaths of workers through the compromises that had to be made that got us to that policy, right? So we know that Southern plantation owners or politicians representing the interests of plantation owners were compromising with Northern politicians around the New Deal. And as a result, Black workers were explicitly excluded from coverage, and specifically in the form of domestic workers and agricultural workers, which, by the way, to this day, we live with that legacy that these are workers who've been excluded from the right to collectively bargain. They've been excluded from the Fair Labor Standard Act, which means basic minimum, you know, labor standards. And so as a result, you know, we've seen, we continue to live with this legacy, but over the years, we see more and more workers surely being excluded from these types of protections. And if you fast forward to today, where the roaring debate that's happening around gig workers and independent contractors versus employees, like, you know, if we're not careful in this moment, we could in fact create a pathway for a whole new set of exclusions that will once again keep mostly Black and Brown workers and many women workers out of these kinds of basic protections and, most importantly, collective bargaining rights.
Can we collectively bargain our way through automation, gigification? Do you have examples?
We can and we have. I mean, many unions. In fact, I think the United Electrical Workers have an entire work kit for many of their locals on how to negotiate over technological changes, including the questions of how the increased productivity and the increased revenue benefits workers. Does it mean that if you don't need as many humans operating a thing, does that mean that people can work less and still be paid more or paid the same? Or even when you look at how many transit unions have been negotiating over automated vehicles, this understanding that even if you don't have a human driver, you still probably need to turn off the automated switch and turn on human decision-making in the event of a potential accident or some kind of mechanical failure.
But I do want you, Sarita, to talk a little bit about domestic workers and how they actually have figured out how to collectively bargain. A bunch of people who don't come to a union hall, and even to use new technologies and apps to strengthen their organizing and to strengthen their bargaining position.
Absolutely. Domestic workers is one of the the National Domestic Workers Alliance is one of the alliances we lift up in the book as examples of some of the innovations that we've seen in recent years. Again, going back to the history, this is a workforce that has been excluded from collective bargaining rights and labor standards, mostly Black women, immigrant women, women of color, that make up this workforce. These are nannies, these are, house cleaners, elder care providers. And so what's fascinating, Laura, is to see the trajectory over the many years, actually, since domestic workers began organizing. And to be clear, they were building on a legacy of organizing. In the book, we talk about the Atlanta washerwomen who were organizing many, many moons
1880s,
ago. 1880s,
right.
Exactly. And that domestic workers today, and especially I would say in the last 10 to 15 years, we've seen this incredible coming together of workers who are, they're winning, you know, the first ever New York State Domestic Workers Bill of Rights that is now spread across the country in a number of states and cities. And that had set basic labor standards, right? Everything from pay to days off, et cetera, to the evolution of that as a tool to the creation of standard boards. And so in Seattle and then Philly and a number of places, we see the coming together of what are like tripartite structures, you know, domestic workers, organizations coming together with industry leaders, coming together with the state or city or county to set standards and to negotiate over training and a number of issues in the industry. To what just happened a few months ago, which is, you know, Domestic Workers Alliance creating a gig worker advocate sort of side of their organization. It was born out of the domestic worker movement, but gig workers who are then on the platform, they were platform workers of Handy, which is one of the largest, you know, platforms for cleaning services. Their Handy pros, which are the workers, were able to actually negotiate a pilot program in Kentucky, Indiana, and Florida, where they were able to negotiate $15 minimum wage, like base pay. They were able to get paid time off, and they were able to win essentially a grievance process. Every month, workers on Handy Pro come together with the managers and talk about what's working or not working on the platform and how to improve their experiences as workers, as service providers on these platforms. And that is huge. And this is like thousands of workers who are being impacted. And I just want to repeat, in Kentucky, Indiana, and Florida, which aren't exactly meccas of progressive policymaking right now.
One of the other things you have in the book is a new map for how to think about these things. I mean, one of the arguments that I hear very strongly through the book and from what you've said is that we need to change where we are putting our expectations about who our leadership is, what the critical issues are, and where this organizing can take place. And in particular, you say there has to be a centering of race and gender, or of, you know, people of color and women, if we want to win. Mm-hmm. So can you just talk a little bit about what's different there from what we normally hear? Well, we need to include people. And that map of yours, Smiley, I understand it was your map.
Look, let me put it this way, right? I mean, being from North Carolina, I was sick of being red all the time and having that not taken to account the history and the movement and the power that came from the people I grew up around. And so, yeah, I mean, look, this is one of those things where it's not simply about inclusion. I think this is really a really important point. It's actually about building and perhaps seeing in the future, building anew, a democracy that we can all see ourselves in, a very different framework than what we've been given. And that it's not so much that what we accomplished before through the New Deal and the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act was wrong. They were really good experiments. We've now seen many of their limitations, and it's time to expand on them so that we can apply a framework that allows everyone to participate in decision-making. And so this map is very straightforward. It actually is just a question of what's the relationship between any given state or county and 20th century forms of democracy, including can they still vote and elect people based on popular support, majority opinion? And can they form and organize unions and negotiate in their workplaces in ways that are based on majority opinion? And what we saw is that in places that had long lost, if they ever had access to 20th century mechanisms of democracy, economic or political, like the Atlanta washerwomen, that in some of these places, working people today had far more appetite for building something new. They weren't just mad about what had been lost. They weren't just feeling left behind by recent institutions and administrations. They actually had an imagination for a 21st century democracy that we could perhaps all get behind. And so I think that's important because, you know, you asked earlier about some of the stories in the book that we really like. Another one really is like the West Virginia teachers. And the idea that gave me, the thing that gave me the idea for this new map, it originally showed up in an article on the JWJ website called Teachers Map the Path to Power. And it was because the three counties that first walked out in those historic teacher actions in 2018 that we were all moved and motivated by were Mingo, Wyoming, and I should, you know, you would think I would learn the third one, but I always forget the third one, and they should totally chastise me about it. But there are the three counties at the bottom, and you would think because they were the first ones who took courageous action that they were like the left vanguard of the state. But in fact, when you looked at a political map, they were like in some of the most conservative areas of the state, like embedded, like in there, ride or die.
And how do you explain that?
Yeah, and how we explain it is very straightforward. In fact, like many of the folks here have a relationship and a history to a movement past. Many of them are the grandchildren and great-grandchildren of people who fought for dignity in the Battle of Blair Mountain. And like their interests were very aligned with many of us who would consider ourselves progressives or even left. They were very clear on dignity, respect, this need of taking care of each other. In fact, the teachers, which sometimes one of the teachers told me, who's in the book, actually told me the story of how her husband worked as a medical technician and like would make sure that he texted her and other teachers every morning if one of the students had a parent or older sibling who had OD'd or who had a problem so that they could adjust and ensure that that student was taken care of and had wraparound services. But that's what community looks like. That's what collectivity looks
that's
like.
Right.
And if you see those values don't always show up in a political map, but those values drive people to act in ways that we might underestimate. And so as organizers, if we aren't looking for that, if we're just looking at the political map, if we're just thinking about the whatever the muddy middle and the soccer moms and whatever the pollsters tell us, we'll actually miss the opportunity to see people take real courageous action. And Laura, just one other thing here, because you asked about race and gender, I want to be really clear. Like, again, it's not simply about inclusion because we don't want to be included at a broken table. We sometimes want a new table, right? And I think many working class white workers, right, have the same reaction. They want a new table. And so what's really exciting about the yellow states on that map and where many workers are in motion, including workers at Amazon, workers in my home state of North Carolina just voted at Starbucks and Boone to form a union. There's a new Amazon committee in Durham, right? So like there's a lot of momentum happening even outside of the traditional locations. And I think it's critical because what it actually shows us is that not only do these workers have a new appetite, but the thing that's motivating them, right? If you listen to some of the interviews of Big Mike from Bessemer, if you listen to some of the interviews of Chris Smalls and other workers in Staten Island, you automatically see that many of the workers saw their fight on the shop floor as their movement for Black lives. The fact that they were over-surveilled by police being a majority Black work site, that was their movement for Black lives. And that was the motivating thing that got people in motion to fight and ultimately in some instances to win. And so that's why we say it's the key to winning.
Some of the more surprising organizing that we've seen in the last few years, whether it's teachers in Chicago or the teachers in West Virginia, is their idea of what is within their purview to organize about. That they organized the entire school, including the janitors, they would not accept to be compromised, just their workplace or just their level of work. And instead they had this kind of inclusive sense of community organizing, which I wonder is sometimes cut off exactly by traditional union organizing strategies and the people that head them up and how they think about how it's always been done. I'm all in favor of going to places that haven't been organized because they might actually have a better idea of how to do it.
That's right.
That's Am I allowed to say that on this program? Sarita, go.
Well, I was going to say that's exactly right. And some of the examples we lift up through the story of Allison and Heather, who are the two West Virginia teacher worker leaders, is this idea that you can use traditional bargaining to raise issues that are broader than what is deemed permissible at the bargaining table. It's, you know, really seeing bargaining as a site of struggle. And that, you know, the most recent examples of this certainly are bargaining for the common good, right? And some of the examples you're lifting up, Laura, is exactly that. The fact that Chicago Teachers Union was able to build in through their contract negotiations the ability to have services for homeless students and families, or in Minnesota where they were able to stop raids, immigration raids in their schools and in their communities. I mean, there are a multitude of examples, and going back to West Virginia, that you really understand that there was a moment, if you read the story of Allison and Heather, they talk about, and the campaign, there was a moment where they won. They could have just not gone on, you know, continued their work stoppage, but they decided, no, this is about other state employees. This is about public education as a whole. This is about us fighting for what we know communities need and families need and what our future really needs to include. And that is what's so compelling about these strategies, is to think expansively about what we can bargain over and should be bargaining over with whichever vehicles allow us to do it, but that bargaining is one vehicle through which we can do that effectively.
This is the fundamental idea that we really want people to digest when we think about collective bargaining, when we think about voting, when we think about democracy, period, is that it is an everyday practice that we should all be able to do in all elements of our lives, regardless of who we work for, where we live, what our background is. It's just the basic practice of consulting, conferring, and ultimately making decisions together about our shared lives.
You actually say anti-labor is anti-democracy. And yes, now that you're talking systems, Sarita, you work for our foundation now. Can you have economic democracy under capitalism? Small question.
Small question, Laura.
Well done, Laura. Well done.
You can have economic democracy. We need to have economic democracy, but it's not going to happen unless more people are demanding economic democracy. And that, again, is, and for us, again, to like broaden the aperture of what we mean by democracy, that democracy movement in our country needs to be about both political voice and political democracy and economic democracy. And if we don't wed the two together, we are not going to get out of the fragility of our democracy today that we see.
Well, with me now is Marianne LeNabat, campaign lead organizer with the NewsGuild of New York and an organizer and trainer with the IWW, that's the Industrial Workers of the World. She is the editor of Organizing Work and an adjunct labor studies professor at the CUNY School of Labor and Urban Studies. Welcome, Marianne. Glad to have you. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So we just heard a very, I think, kind of cheering and rousing discussion of the ways in which collective bargaining could be done by more people around more topics more often in this century of ours. At very first swipe, have any immediate reactions?
I mean, I agree the most important thing is for working people to figure out how to get their needs met and to deploy the power, the leverage that they have in order to do so. And sometimes that takes the form of what we traditionally recognize in terms of labor organizing, filing for a certification election, bargaining a contract, and other times it can take very different forms, because wherever workers have power and leverage, they can go after their demands, basically.
So what do you see happening out there? I mean, you're working with the NewsGuild at this point, but you've also worked with some of the folks at Starbucks and Amazon. What's your sense of the sort of landscape when it comes to labor organizing today?
So the landscape is exciting on the one hand, and people are rightfully excited because that there was that tremendous victory in Staten Island at Amazon, which involved thousands of workers, that facility, to defeat a company like Amazon, which we know is extremely you know, vicious when it comes to its employees just on a regular day-to-day basis, but especially when it comes to unionization, to defeat them is a very big deal. And the same thing goes for Starbucks. If you have Howard Schultz or the CEO du jour flying out to, you know, what, like a 20-person store in Buffalo to try to desperately convince those workers that they don't need a union, that tells you something about the lengths those companies are willing to go to and how much of it is of an accomplishment it is to defeat them and actually win a certification. Same thing has been happening in media in New York. There's been a rash of elections at media companies in the last 5 years at the News Guild. A lot of them happened before I joined the News Guild, not taking credit for them. But there's been some uptick in excitement about unions, some uptick seemingly in certifications, although you'd have to really look at the real numbers from the Labor Relations Board, because sometimes we get excited about things in the media that aren't reflecting real trends. And an uptick in public opinion that is supportive of unions. And all of that is a good thing. But as any worker involved in those campaigns can tell you, the real battle starts after you win that certification, because it's one thing for the government to say, well, legally, the employer has to sit down at the table with you now and bargain with you. But it's a completely other thing to actually win concessions from that employer.
I mean, we've seen it at Amazon. You talk to the organizers of that warehouse that won its recognition on the 1st of April. One of them, at least, hasn't had a job in 2 years. They were let go. They were fired basically for their organizing. And it's not just them who face that kind of backlash.
Yeah, exactly. And there have been a lot of Starbucks workers fired for their organizing as well. The law says that you can't be fired for organizing, but we also overall have a system of at-will employment. So your boss will fire you for, you know, not having a good attitude or being 5 minutes late a few weeks ago or whatever. And there's no such thing as just cause or progressive discipline if you don't have a union contract. And what employers do is they look at the law, they know the law, but they take a calculated decision, a cost-benefit analysis, and they say, if we fire these workers and make an example of them for organizing, that's going to have a chilling effect on the organizing efforts elsewhere. And all of that is taking place in relation to something that workers very clearly have a right to. So it is unambiguous in the law that you have the right to form a union. You have the right to talk to your colleagues and coworkers about forming a union. You have the right to petition for an election. That could not be more protected in law. And yet you see what the actual repercussions are for that. That's the easy part, because after that is the bargaining. Just because the employer recognizes you as a union does not mean that they have to give you anything. And they will fight you as hard as they can. So a couple of things are standard in the playbook now. We're seeing this at Starbucks. I'm seeing this in campaigns that I work on, where the employer will immediately extend a better deal to the non-union workers as a way of trying to convince workers that unionization is pointless, that they will be punished if they do it. Employers often say as much in what are called captive audience meetings when workers are organizing. So they will fight unions at every turn. But I also kind of want to make the point that for as much as the law protects workers' rights to organize, I'm not convinced that the law is really trying to build worker power. It's trying to build an orderly exchange of proposals between workers and employers. It's not really trying to develop the power of the working class.
So you, if I'm hearing you right, you're saying that the whole structure isn't set up for workers, really, for their benefit.
I always draw people's attention to the full title of the National Labor Relations Act, which is something like an act to diminish the causes of labor disputes burdening and obstructing commerce. So the real agenda of the government was to get workers back into workplaces and get the economy running again. And in order to do so, they legislated that employers had to sit down with unions, with workers, and bargain with them. But what that looks like today, and there's been a lot of, you know, decisions and case law and whatnot unfavorable to workers. The law has gotten more constraining and less favorable. But in general, what that system has produced is the notion, the fiction that you're going to meet the employer, you as the workers, are going to meet the employer at the table as an equal without, you know, just by virtue of the fact that the government said they have to recognize you and without causing disruption. The reality is you always have to cause that disruption.
Now, the other part of what Smiley and Sarita Gupta talked about was what can be negotiated about, and that perhaps we've kind of lost the practice of thinking about collective bargaining in all sorts of arena. Do you have interesting examples of people sort of collectively bargaining for unexpected things?
oh, this happens all the time. I mean, I'll just draw one from my own experience. So I used to live in a building very close to Ground Zero, what was then Ground Zero. It had been covered in dust, and in fact, the tenants couldn't even come back to it for a couple of years after 9/11. And the landlord simply did not take good care of it. And so the one or two, you know, noisy tenants had complained about things and asked for things to, for the hallways to be cleaned and for the hallways to be painted, and they weren't getting any response. So a neighbor of mine organized all of us to talk to each other about the problems. Then we all collectively signed a petition, and then we sent it to the landlord, property management company, whatever, with all of our emails attached. And the first thing they said was to the person who had sent the email, please do not include the other tenants in your correspondence with me, which tells you a little bit about what they're afraid of. And I think like within 2 days, they had cleaned the hallways and painted a couple of paint swatches on the wall. This had nothing to do with legal processes. It was very spontaneous in a way, but it shows what you can get if you raise a specter of a collective threat by coordinating with your tenants, with your coworkers, what have you.
Well, that's a great story. And thank you, Marianne LeNabat. That's it for our show today. If you have comments or questions, please write to us at cityworks@slu.cuny.edu. For CityWorks, I'm Laura Flanders. Thanks for watching.